This is interesting. Most of the time, when the word gossip appears in your Bible, it's a person, a gossip, instead of being the content of their conversation, the words of a gossip. I want to introduce you to a gallery of gossips, five different kinds of gossiping people, and I want to hone in on what kind of heart motivations might be driving them. Because remember, it's out of the heart that the mouth speaks. The first one is the spy. Proverbs 11:13 says, "A gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy man keeps a secret." The Hebrew word for gossip in that verse is rakil. A rakil is someone who goes about from place to place, spying things out and exposing secrets, often to the highest bidder. We might call them an informer. A spy is someone who loves to get the dirt on someone and then use it to their own advantage. And they're not trustworthy, no matter what they might tell you. A spy betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy man keeps a secret. Don't talk to a spy, or your secrets will be the next ones to be revealed. Now, what could be the motivation for a spy? What kind of a bad heart would bear that kind of bad news behind somebody's back? Well, it could be a lot of things. People are complex and have many different motivations, often mixed together for what we do. But it seems to me that the main motivation is power, a hunger for power. There's something the spy wants, and they'll use your secrets and mine to get it. Because information is power. This one is tempting to me too, because I like to be known as someone who's in the know, someone who knows things, who has the inside scoop. What's that except for a lust for power? The spy has a heart that wants power. Well, if it's power you want, then what you really want is Jesus. Because the power of gossip enslaves, but the power of Christ emancipates. It frees you. Jesus' power is the power that brought him back to life after he was crucified. And it is eternal and available through the Holy Spirit of God. So how did Jesus use his power? He used it to love. He was so powerful, but at the same time, he was the trustworthy man of Proverbs 11:13, someone you could entrust your deepest, most shameful secrets to. A spying gossip betrays a confidence, but a trustworthy man keeps a secret. The second is the grumbler. Proverbs 16:28 says, "A perverse man stirs up dissension, and a gossip separates close friends." Now, that's a different Hebrew word for gossip. It's not rakil, it's nergon. The Hebrew dictionaries say that a nergon refers to murmuring about another person behind their back rather than openly complaining about their behavior. The root word is the same word used to describe the people of Israel when they grumbled in their tents. Did the Israelites go directly to the Lord and talk to him about their problems? No, they sat in their tents in secret and grumbled. Now, of course, he heard them. You can't really talk behind the Lord's back, but you get the idea. The grumbler complains. The grumbler criticizes. The grumbler is upset about something, and misery loves company, so they talk behind somebody's back. We often call it venting. I just need to vent to somebody, when all it really is sinful gossip. This is often where jealousy comes in. If you're envious, you'll be tempted to grumble behind the back of someone who has something that you want, whether it's a job, a car, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, whatever. The gospel remedy to grumbling is contentment and thanksgiving. It's not bad to want something, but it's terrible to want something too much. Isn't that what jealousy, envy is? Christians need to cultivate a heart of contentment with what we have and thanksgiving for what we've been given. Grumbling gossip feels good, even justified and righteous, but it's not good. Contentment feels so much better. Contentment is counting your blessings and knowing that if you have Jesus Christ, you have everything. That's why Paul says in Philippians 4, "I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation." What was the secret? "I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength." Number three is the backstabber. This one is like the grumbler, but it's more active anger, more hateful. Backstabbing gossip overflows from a heart bent on revenge, on retaliation. The backstabber engages in malicious gossip out of a desire for the target of the gossip to be hurt, to experience pain. Now, that might be by spreading lies. We call that a smear campaign, the stuff that political campaigns are made of. It might also be spreading truth to harm others. Many churches split over malicious gossip. Backstabbing is an age-old problem. It happened to King David. It also happened to King Jesus. Our Lord knows what it means to be betrayed. Backstabbing gossip comes from a heart bent on revenge. It's anger to the point where you want some other person to pay for it. And gossip is a delicious way to do it, because they don't even know until it's too late what's going on. What does the gospel say to backstabbers? It's not just, don't do it, cut that out. As true as that is, it doesn't go very deep into the heart. The gospel says to the backstabber, justice will be done. Justice will be done. But you need to leave it in the proper hands. God will take care of it. On His timetable, in His own way, but perfectly, justice will be done. That's why Romans 12 says, do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, says the Lord. Only a Christian can truly do that, because we know something about justice, that every wrong will be paid for, either at the cross or in the eternal judgment. And that can change our hearts. Number four is the chameleon. The chameleon is that person who goes along with gossip to try to fit in with the crowd, maybe at the local diner. Everybody's doing it, and we don't want to be left out. If you're a chameleon and you're talking with the spy, you're under a lot of pressure to share some tittle-tattle yourself, aren't you? What could be in the heart of the chameleon? What's driving that behavior? The Bible calls it the fear of man. Proverbs 29:25 says, fear of man will prove to be a snare, but whoever trusts in the Lord is kept safe. A chameleon is worried about what other people will say about them, think about them, or do to them. They're afraid of being excluded. But the gospel speaks to that too, doesn't it? It says, fear God, not people. Fear God, not people. Not fear Him in a slavish, scared way, but to have a mind that's full of who God is. And God is holy and omnipotent and awesome and my Father. To have a view of God that says I'm included where it counts the most. If I see God as big and loving me in that way, then I won't worry about what other people might say or do or think. I won't have to gossip. And number five and last is the busybody. This is the person who is idle, who isn't engaged in purposeful business. It's the person who likes to engage in other people's business. It's the kind of person who comes to the diner and says, who's on the menu today? Not what's on the menu, but who's on the menu? Who are we going to talk about? This is the person who wants to be entertained. They gossip for titillation and living vicariously through the stories of others. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, Paul explains to Timothy what to do about the widows. See, this church had a list of widows that they cared for, but you had to be a certain kind of widow to make the list. Basically a godly one, but also an older one, because the younger widows who are going to have some particular temptations if they're put on a list like this. 1 Timothy 5 says, they get into the habit of being idle and going about from house to house. And not only do they become idlers, but also gossips and busybodies, saying things they ought not to. Do you see how this one works? If you aren't busy with productive, purposeful, godly activity, you can easily get sucked into becoming a gossipy busybody. Now hear me, this is not just a woman thing. 1 and 2 Thessalonians teach us how men get into being busybodies themselves when they aren't working. This is not a guy or gal thing, this is a sinner thing, and we're all that. Here's where boredom becomes a key factor. Escape from boredom is a major motive for gossip in our culture. That's why there are gossip columns in the newspaper, gossip shows on television, gossip blogs with the latest information about whoever's on the cover of People magazine. We gossip about people for our entertainment. So here's the slogan I've begun to preach to myself. The foolish people of the world do not exist for my entertainment. I need to remember that. The foolish people of the world, and there are lots of them, do not exist for my entertainment. Well, that's not how God treats people, is it? God loves people, and He treats them with much more mercy than they deserve. God loved me, and I've been a fool. But in love, God sent His own Son to die for this fool and to give His word and His spirit to make me wise. The gospel escape from boredom is active service, active mercy for other people, including those who do not deserve it one bit. You see what we've done here? With this gallery of gossips, with every kind of gossiper, there are heart motivations that are driving the gossip. Because out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And for every one of those that is bad, there's a remedy in the gospel of Jesus Christ. The truth of the gospel, the truth of the promises of God, knowing Christ in personal relationship and the power of the Holy Spirit, all of this is enough to change our hearts so that we can resist being found in the gallery of gossips.
These Resisting Gossip videos are a gift to the world from CLC Publications. Please download, use, and share them with others. Each video corresponds with a chapter in Resisting Gossip and a lesson in Resisting Gossip Together, a participant's guide and Bible study. If you'd like your own copy of these videos, a complete DVD set is available through CLC Publications. The purpose of CLC is to make evangelical Christian literature available to all nations so that people may come to faith and maturity in our Lord Jesus Christ. To learn more, please visit clcpublications.com.
Falling down a hill, I hit my head. The people shouted, "Oh no, Jack is dead." But I woke up and found myself instead in a brand new world.